here today. This is a very important topic for us. And I want to just first introduce the people in the room that are with me from the city and county, because I'm joined today by Krishna Jayaram, who is our Deputy Managing Director, Don Takayuchi Apuna, who is our Acting Head of DPP, Scott Humber is in the back room, Director of Communications, and Andy Kawano is also in the room for Budget and Fiscal Services, our Director. They would be available for any questions when I've finished, if necessary. But I've asked to take this topic on today myself, because this has been a subject of a lot of discussion here because of the commitment we had to reclaim our neighborhoods, given what we witnessed. So let me give a little historical context just to start this. The subject of short-term vacation rentals has been around for a long time. It's been building for quite a while. But in 2019, we hit a high water mark. We hit a high water mark in that we had 10.6 million visitors come to our islands. And in those 10.6 million visitors, they brought a lot of money. You know, the revenue on that base that year was over $18 billion. It resulted in over $2 billion in sales tax, which was great revenue for the state. But within that 10.6 million number, we had 3 million people stay in illegal vacation rentals. And that was a high water mark. And in fact, if COVID had not happened in 2020, the model was projected that we would probably be the first year that Hawaii would have broken the 11 million mark. And when you consider the fact that in our discussions with the hotels, we've had numerous conversations in the past about capacity on what they have on an annualized basis at a significantly high level of occupancy. The sweet spot's about 7 to 8 million. And we're not building new hotel rooms. And so with added visitors, they're likely all going to some kind of vacation rental, legal or otherwise. So what happened in 2019 became a very different realization. We felt overrun. Local people felt subordinated. I think, quite honestly, a lot of visitors didn't get the experience that they had hoped to get, because there were long lines, there was a shortage of access. There were just a lot of things that just felt like we were suddenly really overcrowded, not the least of which was the wear and tear on our island home, the very thing that we want to protect. We just don't have that capacity. So in that regard, during the campaign, this subject of short-term vacation rentals came up just as much, I can promise you, as my discussions on homelessness, my discussions on rail, my discussions on affordable housing. This is a major issue, and we made a major promise coming in that we would find a way to deal with that. And so we did. We wanted to craft a bill that we felt we could enforce. That was the biggest thing, that would be clear and easy to understand for all parties, and that we had to take back our neighborhoods. Okay? Now, I've listened to compelling arguments on both sides. We've been to neighborhood board meetings. We've had lots of feedback on this. And I understand that on both sides of the equation, but the preponderance of people that live here want to live in neighborhoods that haven't been converted into, you know, round robin guests showing up all the time. So that said, that's where we are. That's what brought us to this moment. Now, Judge Watson is, you know, he's introduced a preliminary injunction, and we're going to continue to defend the 30 to 89 ban as part of our long-term zoning planning. I just want you to know that. I was disappointed, but we're going to continue to defend that. But we are set and ready to go forward with the enforcement that was not prohibited by the preliminary injunction. And this is what we have geared up for all these many months here, as we've waited this 6 months to begin enforcement on October 24th, Monday. So in that regard, we've put together, first of all, unprecedented resources to deal with this. So we have a dedicated team of 7 professionals, all of whom are going to be full-time, who have experience as inspectors. They're going to be totally focused on this. And then in addition to that, if we have to add resources, we will. But we feel comfortable right now with our team of 7 starting out, because in addition to that, we've employed a short-term rental computerized monitoring system. Now, this is going to sweep 60 websites. And it's going to be able to identify for us names and addresses and everything else that we need to know. Now, we looked at the mapping software, and to give it a perspective, some 10 to 14,000 homes, as many as that, as many as 14,000, were engaged in short-term rentals, illegal short-term rentals. Adding to that, where do those 3 million people stay? Okay? And that's just not an acceptable situation. So the software technology combined with a dedicated enforcement team, it's a big leg up, and it's not anything that we ever had before from enforcement, because the city has, in all candor, in the past, been charged with the responsibility, Department of Planning and Permitting, to enforce. And it has been hit and miss, somewhat anemic at times, but certainly didn't do anything to curtail what we saw in 2019, but we intend to do just that. So we're also working, as I think I mentioned, with Airbnb and Expedia. I think we have, and Don might help me out, do we have MOUs with them? You know, and it's their intent also for them to, for their clientele, to ensure them, if they work with them, that they'll be staying in a legal vacation rental. All right. So we need to have some teeth to this. So we raised the level of fines. So the fines are $10,000 a day. Okay? So if we discover that you're, if you're advertising, you have an illegal vacation rental, your fine will be $5,000, and we're going to give you a day to take it down. If you persist and you keep it up, it will go to $10,000 a day thereafter. And we also compromised on the fact with, you know, understanding the condo hotels. So much of this bill was predicated on getting back our neighborhoods. You know, it was our intent when we asked for the 90 days was to try to stimulate owners of these properties to take longer-term rentals, in part because we had such a housing crisis going on. There are local families in need of places to stay and rent, and those properties had come off the market. And so we wanted to have a longer period of time to help stimulate that. We felt that that would be a win-win all the way around. But losing that temporarily doesn't diminish our ability to enforce. Okay? And I want to make that really clear today. This is something that we are adamant about on a going forward basis. So let me just say it since before anybody brings it up. I don't care what hasn't happened in the past. I care about where we are now and what we do going forward and what it represents for the people of our island on Oahu, all those neighborhoods and all those families. So we compromised on the subject of the condo hotels. And so we have four districts that people can register in. There are two in Waikiki, one in Ko'olina, and one in Turtle Bay. And you can see here, they can start registering on Monday at this website that's here, which is honolulu.gov/DPPSTR. Is it backslash? Is that how you say that? Backslash, right? I'm still up on that. Okay, backslash, okay? And it's right here. It goes into effect Monday. So if you have a condo hotel in Waikiki or in Turtle Bay or Ko'olina and you intend to do short-term rentals, we're saying okay to that pending your registration and our approval. We're going to allow that. But if you have one of those properties and you don't register with us and you continue to rent that out or attempt to rent it out, and we discover that, which we have every confidence we will, the fine will be $10,000 a day, and we'll continue that way. Okay? I think the biggest thing that I think is going to really help us in what we want to get done, because we've heard the voices from our neighborhoods, we've heard the voices, I've been very supported and encouraged by the neighborhood groups that have come forward, is that we're going to actually ask, we are asking today, for the neighborhoods to help us. We want your help. And we've dedicated a confidential hotline, which is right down here in front of the screen, 787-STVR, for people to call so that they have that opportunity with the state. And I think at the beginning, it's going to go down to it's going to go originally right now to a message, I think, and then it's going to go right to the team once we begin next week. Okay? But we really need the people to help us. Now, look, I believe in the greater good. And I believe in doing things, you know, for that purpose. And I also believe in the goodness in people. And I don't think that people want to have liens on their home. And I don't think that they want to feel overrun either. And we're not looking to harass anybody or to punish anybody, but we've got to take control of this situation. And we will, because we're going to be unyielding in our efforts here. So everything remains intact. There was a lot of speculation as to what did that preliminary injunction mean to us. What that preliminary injunction mean to us is just we have to continue that in court. But we begin enforcement as we had planned to do so this coming Monday with as much aggression as we possibly can, and more so than ever before. And that's what we're looking at on a going forward basis. So with that, I'll open it up to any questions. Rick.
Mayor, you know, the judge's ruling seems to say that the city's 90-day requirement conflicts with state law, which is 30 days. Given that, you know, that conflict, do you think it's game over for the city to enforce a 90-day requirement?
I don't think anything is game over, and I don't want to speculate and predict what we may not be able to do in court, but I can tell you right now, at 30 days, we still know that we can enforce. One of the other reasons why I didn't mention this, and I'll say it, that we wanted the 90 days, because we know from past practice, talking to the inspectors and their efforts to monitor, that they would knock on a door at a house, and everybody that was checking into these places was showing them a certificate. Oh, I'm here for 30 days. Well, we knew that they weren't here for 30 days. And quite honestly, if I could just add one other thing about the 30 days. 30 days still is highly disruptive to a neighborhood. That's a frequency of 12. That's what we're looking to avoid. It's ideally now. Look, I've been coming to Hawaii since I moved here in 1965. I was just on an airplane this week. Invariably, I travel with tourists. I always ask them, how long are you coming for? And typically they say, oh, a week, 6 days, whatever. I don't think I've ever heard anybody say, I'm coming for 30 days. This presupposes something that doesn't happen. Okay, and then make it matters worse, it's a real shibai when they can hold up a piece of paper saying for an inspector knocks on the door. Then worse yet, when they're left to try to call the mainland owner, of which so many of these properties are owned by absentee owners, not just on the mainland but elsewhere, and they can't reach those people. So we're going to fine aggressively at unprecedented levels, and if in fact those fines are not paid, we're going to put liens on properties. Okay, we don't want to do that, but we will do that.
Work around that. The city could seek the state legislature to change the law to 90 days too. I mean, is that something in one of your options?
I think it is one of our options. I don't want to project that going forward, but obviously, if I were to tell you that, you know, first we want to deal with Judge Watson, we'll see where that goes. We want to begin our enforcement intact. And I think that once people understand that we're doing that, somebody the other day, in fact, it was Ian Shering that mentioned to me, he talked about the behaviors we have in the HOV line. You know, we don't have that many police officers over there, but we have great obedience in HOV lines. But at some point, you develop the ground rules. That's what this is about. I'm not looking to punish anybody, but that's what this is about. These are the ground rules. Stay within the rules, and you're going to be just fine. You go outside of the rules, you're going to deal with us in an unprecedented way, because that's what's at stake right now. So, and then the ultimate point to you is if we have to go to the legislature, we're prepared to take this as far as we have to take it because of what's at stake. I raised a family here. My kids grew up in a neighborhood. You all, maybe many of the people listening to us right now, our neighborhoods are a really important part of how we live here. You know, it is such a part of how we grow up here and live here, okay? And we're not going to have them overrun.
Mayor, just to be clear, so the city can begin enforcing all of the provisions in the 22-7 except the 30 to 89 days that's banned by the preliminary
injunction. That's correct.
The intent to. And the city, just to be clear, the city disagrees with Judge Watson's assessment that it's in conflict with state law? Because I had heard that there may have been a city opinion that there was a conflict.
No, it's a preliminary injunction. We tend to go forward defending the position on the 3089.
Okay, and then I just wanted to talk about DPP. In terms of, you've got 7 people dedicated now to this endeavor. Is that the most you've had before? Because it seems like in the past you might have had more dedicated inspectors.
No, we've never had full-time, as I understand it. Historically, we looked at this. We've never had 7 full-time people dedicated to doing it. And as it is, DPP has been understaffed for a long time.
And can you talk about the understaffed? How understaffed are they?
Well, we actually plan to try to hire 80 people in this coming year, 40 replacements and 40 new positions. Finding people in today's job market has made that extraordinarily difficult, especially people with the expertise that we need. Well, we were public earlier in saying we're going to hire 160 people for DPP over the course of the next, now to be about 30 months, the next 2.5 years. Okay, that we've put that into it. Half of those, 80, are going to be replacement people, and the 80 are going to be new people. But in addition to that, we're also investing in software, not just this monitoring that we're using for, but additional software to bring us into the 21st century. And we're hoping that with all of that and some great leadership, and Dawn is in the room, Dawn Takeuchi Apuna is our acting director, who's already gotten off to a tremendous start with her team over there, that it, you know, we want to improve morale. You know, we've got a lot of good people working in DPP. It's been so hard to deal with all the criticism, the frustrations which we understand because of the interminable delays that weren't necessary and all the other things we inherited after decades of neglect. To try to fix this quickly has not been easy to do, especially under the circumstances. But I have every confidence not only in leadership, but I have a lot of confidence in our plans, which required money, which we only got the ability to spend as recently as this fiscal budget, which began in July. So a lot of our efforts have gone into planning, now we're into execution. But if we could find the people sooner rather than later, we would.
Just one more question about the department.
Yes.
Any plans for a permanent director?
There are plans for a permanent director. And right now, you know, Dawn is doing a great job, and my bet is on Dawn, but I want to be sure it's the right situation for her.
Mayor.
Yes.
So just to clarify, right, you said you will defend this measure, this law, but with the injunction, are you going to appeal it?
Yes. I think that's the legal procedure. I have a lawyer in the room here to help me out, Krishna. Okay. I'm not a lawyer. So when we get into language like defend, contest, I've learned the hard way that you've got to be careful how you say those words. I know we're going to defend this. How would you articulate that, Christian?
So thank you, Mayor. So Christian Jarom, Deputy Managing Director. So we will be defending our position going forward. Whether that means we're going to appeal the injunction or we're going to do something else, that's something that we're discussing with the attorneys. But the mayor has given clear direction that we're going to continue fighting this.
I'm going to say it again. A 30 days is a frequency of 12. That's very disruptive to a neighborhood. And that's not even real. Can you imagine 12 in a given property, 30-day renters back-to-back? I mean, that just doesn't happen. So we want to stay grounded. I said in the opening comments on our plans here is to have common sense and clarity. I also want to deal in reality, okay? And so in this regard here, while we understand individual rights, the cumulative impact of what's happened here, the fact that we had 3 million people in illegal vacations in 2019, and quite honestly, if you look at our pacing for tourism, we're right back on track to exceed 2019 numbers probably come 2023. And so this is a very important measure for us right now to be able to implement, to offset, if you will, what we experienced in 19, never to happen again.
Over the weekend, I ran into some visitors. They were staying on the Gold Coast, and she goes, I'm not sure if it's legal or illegal. It's legal, obviously, on the zone. But that's part of the calculus in some of the visitors, what I thought. What are you hearing in terms of visitors, whether they're, now that they're aware of this law, are they consciously trying not to?
We haven't really heard anything from visitors yet. In that regard, we spent time listening to neighborhood boards and other constituencies. But I suspect that people will learn about that once we get into the enforcement area, and then that'll be that kind of a discussion. We'll find out. Look, this is not unique to Hawaii. Visitor destinations elsewhere have had to deal with this same phenomena, you know, and some have done it very, very well. And we think we're going to do it very well. It's about political will, if I can say that, okay? People bring that up all the time. I'm going to tell you right now, we're not here. This team, this legislature, what we're planning to do, we're serious about it. If I deliver any message today to this group of people and to the people of this island, okay, we're very serious about this, and we mean business, and we will enforce in an unprecedented way, because what's at stake right now could not be any more important to the people of this island. Yes.
So, Mayor, in terms of the registration, just wanted to clarify that. That's for those properties that are in the resort district.
Yes.
They want to do the.
Yes. And there's two in Waikiki.
Built for the 90-day minimum, but now it would be.
They can rent for less than 30 days.
That's okay.
Right. They can do that.
Okay. Now,
It's $1,000 to register.
$1,000 to register. And then what happens if you're not registered on the 24th?
Well, no, they can only begin registering.
Renting.
They can only begin to register on the 24th. It starts on Monday. Okay?
Okay. And then how do they have to be registered in order to be renting?
Yes.
And if they're not, what's the penalty?
$10,000 a day.
Okay. Are you concerned with the website just going up on Monday that you might have an overload and it might be difficult for everybody to get registered?
Well, I think what we'll do is we'll go through those clients as we process that. I think, look, we're looking to be fair and reasonable people. So we're going to start something on the 24th. We couldn't start that sooner, okay? And I think this whole thing is going to be an educational process. I've said it a couple of times today. I'm going to say it again. As serious as I am about the business of this, we don't want to punish anybody. We want people to comply and everybody understand it for the greater good. I hope that this is not coming off as threatening. This is just coming off as saying, these are the ground rules. These are the ground rules, and we need this kind of structure.
Is there a grace period, though, if everybody can't get registered?
Well, we're going to see how we deal with that load of people coming in. Right now, and I'm looking at Dawn, and she's nodding because we've had this very, it's a great question. You know, we think we can handle that on the registration. It's a fairly simple registration.
Okay. One other question that I've heard from owners, they were concerned about the Oahu Transient Accommodations Tax Form. They said that there wasn't one yet, and it's required as part of the registration.
Okay.
How do you plan to handle that?
All right, Dawn.
So actually, the transient accommodation tax forms are with the state. And those are already available. They're not going to open up on the 24th or the 23rd. So those are already available.
Well, this would be the county form for the county TAT.
Right. They should be available with the state.
For the county?
Yes. That's right. Correct, yeah.
Okay.
Andy, you want to add to that? This is our Andy's Director of Budget and Fiscal Services. It's had a lot to do with TAT. Good question. I'm glad you're asking
it. Andy Kawano, Director of Budget and Fiscal Services. With regard to the Oahu TAT form, we have a Oahu TAT site that you can actually go through our Honolulu website to get that. It's pretty straightforward. And, you know, most people that are paying the GET already are, you know, filing OTAT, as we call it. So it should be pretty straightforward to get to that form.
On that website?
Yeah.
And it's an OTAT site? Do
yes.
you have the address for that for people?
Not off the top of my head, but we can provide it to
okay,
you.
Great.
We can post it.
One other question I have for Mayor. I had several people send me commentary saying that they had been trying to complain about vacation rentals, but that the complaint form wasn't working for the past 2 months. Are you aware of that? And if there's some way
No, I wasn't aware of that. We have a hotline now. We're going to be pretty aggressive in making sure we can respond. I mean, I think a big part of this, when we talk about enforcement, is going to come from the communities themselves. I really feel that way because having listened to people and how upset they've been and what it's done to not only It's driven up prices. It's disrupted neighborhoods. It's just done a whole lot of things. It's prevented people from even finding places to live. You know, we have a tremendous housing shortage. We know that. We're trying to do everything and everything we can at the city right now to be an active player in the development of workforce housing, affordable housing. We're working with developers to try to incent them to build housing. And now we have existing housing that's been taken off the market. And by the way, I don't know if it was me, and Christian's not in the room if I misspoke, but we want to be really clear on something with respect to the temporary injunction, and that is the preliminary injunction. I'm sorry. We're not appealing it. We're going to defend it. That's really an important point. Okay? We're not appealing it. The language needs to be we're defending it. I think I did use the word defending a couple of times, so just want to be clear about that.
Okay. So just to be clear,
yep.
We have this new hotline starting. That starts Monday.
Yes. No. Does it start sooner or Monday?
It's up now.
It's up now.
I think it started last night.
And that is the only mechanism right now, or are you going to fix the complaint line for online?
Yes. I'm going to say yes to that, but come on up, Don. As I said earlier, we're going to add whatever resources we need to do. So go ahead.
Yes. Yeah, so there's the hotline that's going to open up on Monday, and it'll direct you to, you know, enforcement questions or registration and other related to short-term rentals. And then also our website is being updated too, and it will have a page specifically for short-term rentals where you can register, and there will be FAQs, and just a lot of information that will help people to register. And, oh, I'm sorry, there's also an area to make a complaint. So if you can, you can put in information, upload information about possible violations, and then we will go out and send out an inspector and see what's going on there.
Right, and that's the site that's currently not working.
Right, right. So it'll be there by Monday at the latest, but we are working on that.
Well, we set up a hotline last night, right? The phone is operational now. Yeah, so you know. Okay, good questions. Everybody else? Okay. All right, so I'll say it again. The hotline number, area code 808-768-STVR or 768-7887. And the website to register is honolulu.gov/DPPSTR. It's right here, okay? Look, I thank all of you for being here. This is, I think, in the 21, nearly 22 months of holding different conferences on different subjects, this is something right now that is we take to be most serious, and I hope that that's come across today. And our intentions going forward will be unprecedented for the safety and the well-being of our island home. Okay, so thank you very much.